Hi, everyone. I'm Julian Zelizer, and welcome to this Brennan Center for Justice event. I'm a professor of history and public affairs at Princeton University, and I'm also the co-editor of the book that we are going to be discussing tonight, Myth America: Historians Take On the Biggest Legends and Lies About Our Past. We're really excited to have all of you joining us today. I have a few housekeeping notes just to go over before we start. First, we are going to leave time toward the end for some questions and answers from the audience. If you have a question that you want to ask, please add it to the YouTube or Facebook stream, the message streams, and we'll add it to the conversation. Relatedly, we ask you to moderate your language. Anyone posting something with rude or intemperate language will be, their message will be removed from the stream. And finally, live closed captioning will be provided. For those of you who are joining one of these events for the first time, our hosts tonight, the Brennan Center is a nonpartisan law and policy institute that works on a number of issues and has done phenomenal work in areas such as voting rights. They focus on repairing, revitalizing, and when necessary, defending our systems of democracy and justice. So let's turn to the program for the evening. Disinformation is a term that we hear more and more of, and we hear more of it because it's become more of a problem in American politics. We see much more frequently politicians, pundits, and other sorts of political leaders bending and twisting history and the facts of history to suit their own political purposes. We've seen how history has become incredibly politicized as a topic, as subject matter, as has taken place recently in states such as Florida, leading really to an epidemic of many Americans being flooded with historical fiction over fact, but it becoming increasingly difficult to understand the difference between the two. Kevin and I recruited some of the best historians in the country for the book and for the panel tonight to try to help us work through what we actually know about big issues of the day, issues such as the founding or issues such as immigration and voting rights and voting reform, and to help guide us in a conversation that's rooted in actual research and actual scholarly literature. While battles over history have been taking place since forever, and certainly since the creation of the profession in the late 19th century, what Kevin and I have tried to do is respond to something more recent, where there's a big change in terms of scale and scope, and technology, partisan politics is allowing for a much greater reach for historical material that is totally disconnected from what historians have been writing. Our new book is called, again, Myth America: Historians Take On the Biggest Legends and Lies About the Past. It's a collection of 20 essays from some of the top historians in the country who are not only taking on some big myths that are damaging to the Republic, but also just great historians from the Academy who we wanted to introduce and show and showcase the amazing work that they're doing. So let me introduce the panelists, and then I will ask some questions to guide us through the conversation. First, we have Akhil Reed Amar, who is the Sterling Professor of Law and Political Science at Yale University. We have Carol Anderson, who is the Charles Howard Chandler Professor of African American Studies at Emory University. Kathleen Belew, who's associate professor at Northwestern University. And finally, my co-editor, Kevin Kruse, who's a professor of history at Princeton University and my co-editor on this project. So let me start with some questions. Kevin, why don't I start with you? You and I have been talking about this book for several months now since it came out in early January, and obviously we were working on it before. What have been some of the most surprising things in terms of the reception and conversations about the book that you found since we started this?
Well, the most interesting thing has been a pleasant surprise, has been the reaction to it. And the book was an instant bestseller on the New York Times book list, which neither of us, I think, had in our wildest imaginations. It's tough for an edited collection. I think it speaks to the quality of the contributions we got. And I think it speaks to the hunger that's been out there. As you noted, this is part of a long process of fights over American history, but there's something new about this one. In the past, the fights over American history have been about which facts to stress more. And now we're arguing about what facts are even facts. And it's clear that politics have led us here, as you noted. President Trump began his term in office from day one, from the inauguration, talking about where his inauguration placed in American history, and spent his entire 4 years in office spreading mistruths and misinformation about history, right up to the very end when he promoted this 1776 commission to promote what he called patriotic education. And even after Trump has left office, this has still been kept alive in politics. People like Governor DeSantis, as you noted in Florida, have been actively waging war against what they think is critical race theory, or what they think is woke education, or things like that. And historians, of course, haven't taken this lying down. We've spent this time pushing back in traditional media and also on social media against these lies. And while those have been good formats and have served us well, as you and I talked about this more and more, we realized that we needed to do what historians do best, which is to write. So we got to, these groups together to write some smart, informed essays and name them at the general public.
Akhil, let me turn to you. Your essay is one of the ways in which we start the book, and it deals with founding myths or myths about the founding. And you talk about five widespread and interrelated misunderstandings about the Constitution. Maybe can you give us a Reader's Digest version of two of those myths and why you think the corrections are important to understand?
Okay, so one idea that everyone is taught is that republics are different from democracies, and that the framers believed in republics and not democracies. And they're getting this from the Federalist 10, from James Madison, which they're taught is the big idea. And people didn't read the Federalist 10, and there's not a sharp difference between republics and democracies. And the framers were proud Republicans. They were also proud Democrats. And the second might be that and this is actually a kind of a left-wing version of the same right-wing meme, but from a different perspective. A lot of folks are basically taught, oh, the founders really didn't believe in self-government. It was all about the not the people, but the property. This was, I say in a very punchy way, Beard is bunk. Charles Beard, his disciples, including Howard Zinn, have actually presented a left-wing story that actually converges with the right-wing story, both of which deny that what I think is the truth, which is the basic self-government, popular sovereignty, democratic, republican bona fides of the founding.
Myths about the founders, or genuine and accurate history of the founders, has such a hold on the American imagination when we are debating issues today. It's not inevitable, but why do you think that's the case?
Because the Constitution governs us all, and it has some connection to not these words, but everyone, Kevin says, talked about a president. The first thing a president has to do is to swear an oath to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution. That's an historical document. And so, of course, there are going to be debates about the history behind the text. And, of course, it's really important, and I'm so glad to be here with such distinguished colleagues. Just want to remind everyone, the Constitution isn't just about the founding. There's some pretty important amendments over the course of American history as well. But the debates about the Constitution are going to include, of course, debates about the founding.
And of course, the historian Eric Foner always reminds us that the Reconstruction period and the amendments that came out of that are in many ways as significant to the period we're in today as that original founding, and have to be thought of that way. Let me turn to you, Kathleen. All of us who watched followed what happened, the horrendous events of January 6th. There you saw history front and center, even on some of the banners of the insurrectionists. And your essay deals with some of these questions in our book. What were some of the big historical myths that informed the actions and the violence that took place that day?
So January 6th might best be understood as the collision of three different spheres of political organizing. One is simply the Trump base, Stop the Steal, which within it had sort of a continuum of extremism ranging from a simple democratic or free speech kind of action all the way up to that plus some property damage. A second stream is QAnon, which is a conspiracy theory motivated, disinformation motivated sort of activism that is in many ways new, in many ways rehashes old conspiracies from earlier in the 20th century. And the third is a movement that has a deep history, the White Power Movement, which has been at war on the American government since 1983, has perpetrated major acts of domestic terrorism and is still at large. So this movement, the White Power Movement, is one that has a deep historical archive, has a coherent ideology, has coherent social networks and relationships. And it's probably the smallest of those three groups of activists that came out on January 6th, but it's also the highest organized people, the people who had plans to breach the building, people who had tactical gear, talked with each other about organizing, attempted to bring in weapons, et cetera, et cetera. When we have clearly ideologically motivated action, and we know the history that lets us make those connections, one thing we've seen in the aftermath of January 6th is that the presence of that historical context is what allows for effective prosecution, for instance, seditious conspiracy trials and convictions, and also allows us to push back against the sort of immediate rewriting of that event as, for instance, a normal tourist visit or a simple protest like any other. I think, you know, we know what we saw, but it takes a active sort of confrontation with narrative and meaning making through history to maintain that sense of reality.
And you talk about misunderstandings of the White Power movement of the past. I'm curious, and what are some of the similarities in what's happened before and what has unfolded in the last few decades?
So the White Power movement came together after the Vietnam War. It brought together neo-Nazis, Klansmen, skinheads, militiamen, using the idea of the wrongness of the federal government kind of crystallized through the idea that the Vietnam War was an example of government betrayal of its people, and using that story to bring people together in an anti-government, anti-American groundswell. One of the texts that it used to organize this violence is the Turner Diaries, which is a dystopian novel that our listeners today should absolutely not go and purchase, because sometimes the money from a direct purchase still goes back to these groups. But that novel lays out a sort of plan of attack that has shaped many, many different moments of white power violence. For instance, the Oklahoma City bombing, the bombers circulated that novel ahead of the action, and the bomb itself is based on a scene in the book. This is also true with January 6th, which is based on a scene, an attack scene against the US Capitol in the Turner Diaries. And it gives us the sort of context for how we should think about the meaning of that event within this ideology. For instance, it was not supposed to be a mass casualty event like Oklahoma City. January 6th instead was meant to be a recruitment and radicalization exercise, a sort of strike at the heart of power and bring others into the fold. And we know that it has worked very well in that way, and that we have continued to see intense action in this movement after the 6th.
Let me turn to Carol. You've been writing a lot about one of the biggest issues that has been certainly front and center in the last 6 or 7 years, but really longer, on this kind of rhetoric about voter fraud and the actual history as it relates to the franchise and to voting rights. What's some of the, your essay in our book is about that. And it's connected to the Brennan Center in that the Brennan Center has been working on these issues as well. What are some of the kind of key points of disinformation that we hear about not just voter fraud today, but kind of the role it's played in American history that have been influential in these efforts going on all over the country to restrict the vote.
Thank you for that. One of the things we have to understand about the language of voter fraud is that it is designed to create this sense that American democracy is under attack, that it is under assault, that something precious is being stolen from good, honest, hardworking white Americans. And so that fraud then is identified as happening in minority communities, that you have African Americans who are committing this massive, rampant voter fraud. And so that in order to protect democracy, you have to begin to exclude African Americans from access to the ballot box. And we see this with the Mississippi Plan of 1890. We see it all the way through to what happened after the Shelby County v. Holder decision, which gutted the Voting Rights Act and allowed these states to start implementing these laws. And what the 15th Amendment did was to say that the state cannot abridge the right to vote on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. So what these states have done is to say, we've got to protect the ballot box, but they can't say we don't want Black folks to vote, or we don't want Indigenous people to vote, or we don't want Latinos to vote. And so what they do is they use the kinds of characteristics, where people live, what their poverty rates look like, in order to write the laws. And so this is why you see voter ID laws. This is why you see the shutting down of early voting places in minority communities. This is why you see this kind of disparate action in terms to curtail access to the ballot box. And based on what should be, what is considered to be a legitimate state interest, which is protecting the integrity of the ballot box, but it gets racialized through the language of voter fraud.
And one of the, you have a line that, unless this kind of bad history is, there's a response to it, unless we really contextualize what this language is about and the realities of voting, that the phantom of voter fraud, if that exists, that democracy will be under very real threat of sowing distrust in election results and blocking millions of voters for the ballot box. And can you talk broadly? I mean, there's what you just discussed, connecting the Mississippi Constitution of 1890 to today. We see very real effects of disenfranchisement. But what effect broadly does it have on our democratic culture when politicians such as the former president and others talk about this as a mass phenomenon? And what does it do to our trust in the system, to our trust in government, and our ability to have a vibrant democracy?
And what it does is it actually erodes that trust, because if the elections cannot be trusted, if the results cannot be trusted, if we believe that there are all of these illegitimate people who are deciding that they are somehow American citizens with the right to vote and are casting ballots in our elections, then it does damage to what we can see as a viable, a legitimate office holder. It does damage to the ways that we connect with each other, with the ways that we trust or don't trust what is happening in the system, who our representatives are. And so one of the things about the January 6th insurrection with the Stop the Steal is, remember, you had Newt Gingrich, who said they stole the election in Atlanta. They stole the election in Philadelphia. They stole the election in Milwaukee. And remember that they also had that entire audit process happening in Maricopa County, where you had an incredible turnout of Latinos and Native Americans that helped flip the state, Arizona, to Joseph Biden. And that county was also targeted as basically having this massive, rampant voter fraud. And so when you get the sense that the elections are fraud, the results are fraudulently based because all of these illegitimate people cast their ballots, then that is what leads to, we're taking our house back, we're taking our country back, and the storming of the Capitol. and the violence that happens and the threats to election workers, because it's seen that election workers are doing the work of those who aren't real Americans.
Let me just follow up with one last question I wanted to get to Kevin. I remember once reading, I can't remember if it was a conversation or a speech where Lyndon Johnson was talking about a voting rights bill, an earlier one in 65. And at some point he was talking about elevating voting in civil rights was very effective because who would be against the right to vote? But a lot of people are, as we've learned over time. Why? Why are right now, why are there so many red states that are so focused on the restrictions? What's driving it in 2023?
And this is part of what Kevin was working on, is that when you look at the kinds of demographic and ideological shifts that are happening in the parties. So when the Democrats were a party that was overwhelmingly the party of white supremacy, they worked really hard to keep African Americans from voting, because you had counties and you had states that had sizable Black populations, and that those policies were decidedly anti-civil rights, anti-Black. With the Southern strategy, it moved the Republican Party further and further to the right, and so that its pillars are hyper-patriarchy, hyper-anti-Black, anti-civil rights, and a kind of Christian evangelicalism that is highly exclusive. And so those policies don't resonate with the broader demographic changes that are happening in America. And so if you can't change your policies, if you won't change your policies to meet the needs of that broader demographic, then what you do is you try to exclude that demographic from being able to vote, to exclude them from the reins of power, exclude them from having real representation, exclude them from having their voice heard in the halls of government.
Perfect segue. Let me turn to Kevin and your essay and stick on that Southern strategy, which I think people still hear the term used, but for a long time, it was really a centerpiece of conversations about American politics, what it was about, where it came from. Maybe you could just explain what the Southern strategy is and why did you feel the need to take that particular myth on it, or not the myth of the Southern strategy, but myths about it at this moment in American history?
In short form, I've become that guy. In short form, the Southern strategy was the effort of the Republican Party to basically turn the page on its past of racial liberalism. It had been the party of Lincoln, the party of emancipation, the party of civil rights, and to make peace with the people who had long been their enemies, Southern Democrats who were conservative on other issues, but really resented the Republican stance on civil rights. And this has been a long conventional story. It is written in bright colors all across the newspapers of the 1960s. They talk about this openly. Republican leaders, Republican aides, Republican strategists, they talk about it in their memoirs. They talk about it in their private papers. It's apparent in the polling. It's apparent in the party platforms. This switch was obvious, this transformation. Strategists like Lee Atwater talk about it at a later date and openly acknowledge that the Nixon era made this pivot to the right on race. And in fact, it was so conventional that about a decade ago, Republican leaders were openly apologizing for it. We saw Ken Mellman and Michael Steele, two chairmen of the RNC, who openly admitted to this and said, and we're apologizing for this, and we're going to try to turn the page. Because I think there was in the Bush era a really sincere effort to make the party more multicultural, multiracial, to be embracing of change. Well, what happened was the rise of Donald Trump. And with Trump, there was a new embrace of racist politics, I think pretty starkly. And that led people in his circle not to want to apologize for the past, but instead they decided they would pretend it never happened. And so there was a new wave of partisans that came out and did something that I think would have been unthinkable to any of us just a decade ago, which is to insist that the Southern strategy never happened. The Republican Party had never, ever made an appeal to racists, not in their past and certainly not in their present. And so they denied it. And so that's why I had to write this essay on the Southern strategy being a real thing.
I was thinking about how the debates changed, because years ago, a lot of historians wrote about Reagan and one of his opening campaign speeches, which is in the same area where three civil rights activists were murdered in Freedom Summer in 1964. But I remember the debate more, and maybe I'm not remembering perfectly, but a lot of people criticized those who said that the speech itself was kind of sending a signal about mm-hmm. states' rights and trying to kind of appeal to that coalition. But the debate was, you know, did Reagan intend to do that? Were there yeah. other reasons? It wasn't, did the whole strategy exist or not? Right. It was simply, and it's incredible how the debate has now changed to just, let's yeah. just pretend the whole thing didn't happen.
Yeah. And that's the famous Lee Atwater interview he does in 1981, where he says, look, clearly the 1960s Southern strategy was racist. He says the Harry Dent strategy, Harry Dent was Nixon's main advisor for the South, that was predicated on coded racism. We all know that. But he insisted what we're doing today under Ronald Reagan is something totally different. This is completely divorced. We've got to move beyond that now. And so instead of denying that current Republican policies are tied to this admitted racist past, they're pretending that past never happened at all.
And why do you think this is, I'll open this to everyone and maybe I'll call on someone, but I'm sure everyone has a level of frustration that there's often such a disconnect with what historians and historical social scientists, what they're working on. They spend decades doing research on what's being written, not in one book, but in 100 books. And it's kind of familiar material, whether it's the mm-hmm. Southern strategy or any of the issues we're discussing. And yet there's a lot of the public right now, which clearly is open to a much more hostile understanding of what's going on in the academy, and that is not interested in kind of hearing what scholars have to say. I mean, I think that's part of the tensions in American public life. And I'm curious to anyone, maybe Carol, you can start, but kind of what's driving that tension and kind of how do we respond to it?
I think that a large segment of it is part of what Kathleen deals with, which is the anti-intellectualism, the anti-education component that is in this larger group that resents the changes that are happening in America. And I liken it to the Archie Bunker theme song, you know, where, you know, girls were girls and men were men, and guys like us, we had it made, and you didn't need no welfare state. I mean, all of those things, that longing to that way back then past, which is actually a past that is really oppressive and racially exclusive. And that is the work that scholars do, is laying this real history out so that we understand how we got here. And when you have that strong strain of anti-intellectualism coursing through a large part of the body politic, then you get politicians who tap into that vein. And when they tap into that vein, it leads to state legislators banning certain types of majors from being taught. It leads to the defunding of public libraries. It leads to the censorship that is happening. It leads to the kind of vilification of education, so that you can have a governor that has Ivy League degrees and he dismisses his Ivy League degrees to show that he's part of the folk. That is part of what this is.
And let me remind everyone, soon they're going to start sending me some of the questions on the stream. So make sure you get them in. We're going to turn to that pretty soon. Kathleen, a different version. You've been front and center in the last few years as a historian who's trying to translate your knowledge as events such as whether it's January 6th or Charlottesville are happening. What do you think the challenges are from your perspective of trying to, and I don't just mean if you're on TV, but kind of whatever format, speaking, writing, radio, whatever it is, or being on television, what are the challenges to you of trying to talk about the history of something like white power and white supremacy in real time and connecting them to unfolding events?
Sure. Well, so I'm a historian, so I'm always giving this caveat about I'm just here to interpret, you know, I'm here to help us know what we can learn from the past. And a lot of what we do in spaces like public commentary is have people ask us to make the kinds of predictions and comparisons that historians are just deadly allergic to. And you'll hear these like, is this like the flu of 1919? Is this like the recession of whichever recession? Is this like the Great Depression or more like the end of the Cold War and things like this, right? I understand why people have that conversation, but historians deal in complexity. And so for us to translate in that direction is sometimes difficult. But I would add to what Professor Anderson was saying by saying that I think, you know, despite a enormous effort to avoid teaching our populace about their history. And, you know, I'm thinking of the work of people like Elizabeth McRae, who trace the efforts of segregationist activists to undermine the telling of history all the way back through the 20th century. So we look at people trying not to talk about Jim Crow, people trying not to talk about integration, people trying not to talk about the Civil War in ways that will allow the perpetuation of racist structures. Despite all of that, despite things like, you know, right now it's DeSantis, but people in Arizona went after ethnic studies there when ethnic studies students were causing a lot of problems politically. This is an old trick. Despite all of these efforts, my feeling is that most people are really interested in history. And one way we know is that our politicians are able to tap that button. I think even something like Make America Great Again as a slogan is an argument about our history. It supposes an action. It supposes a period of greatness. I would like to know more about who's included, when that was. Do we all agree it was great? What exactly was great? Who exactly is eligible for this? These are historical arguments. So to my mind, this is effective work. In a volume like this, like Myth America, that exactly is about this translating our scholarly research into a kind of historical telling that's for everybody. I think this is exactly the kind of tool that can really move some people. So I'm just really excited when I see opportunities like this to do that kind of bridge building.
Thank you. Akhil, you teach at a law school, and in law, history has a very pronounced and important place, in part because of the Constitution, in part because of theories such as originalism. And I'm curious from your perspective, which is a little different than ours in terms of where you come from with pedagogy and your intellectual agenda, how is history important and understanding history accurately? How is it important to training people who are going to be judges and lawyers and to our own ability to interpret and analyze big legal questions?
So unlike pure historians who might be allergic to saying, what does 1919 mean for today? That's what lawyers have to do all the time. We actually take something from the past and then decide whether plaintiff wins or defendant wins today. I'm an originalist. I happen to be liberal. And I think Abraham Lincoln was an originalist. And when he says 47 years ago, he's actually appealing to something that's not in the living memory of anyone in the audience. He's going back to the founding in a certain way, and he's telling a certain story. And the question is he telling a correct story or not? Dred Scott claims it's being faithful to the Constitution and the founding. Is it really? History is complicated. What I loved is I heard, my party, the Democratic Party, was the party of segregation and slavery, and now the modern day Republicans. So, think history is complicated, and good lawyers, I think, appreciate the complexity of history. One final point on Make America Great Again and anti-intellectualism. I think lots of ordinary people, because the academy isn't always right. And actually, I'm taking on myths in the academy and not just myths in politics. Ordinary people do understand that some of what America did really was great. So in my essay, I say, the Electoral College was actually all about slavery. and three-fifths. And it's not because they didn't believe in democracy, it's because they believed in democracy and also slavery. How can you believe in both? Well, Andy Jackson believed in both. That's complicated. On the other hand, so it is about slavery. It's also true that the founding, more people got to vote than ever been allowed to vote on anything before in human history. And the seeds of abolition, ending slavery, that those seeds actually are in Philadelphia. America gives doesn't give the world slavery in 1619. Oh, we had it long before that. America actually does give the world the idea of abolition in all the northern states, precipitated by the American Revolution. So it's complicated, lawyers at their best try to learn the history and apply it to today without oversimplifying.
I think, just to follow up on that, one of the terms or concepts you hear all the time these days is unpatriotic history. And I hear this constantly, and it's used in states like Florida that kids are learning an unpatriotic version of this country, and they're just learning about what's bad about the country. And Kevin's heard me say this probably too many times at this point, but I don't understand that concept. I mean, I always really think to be truly patriotic is to kind of study everything and understand every part of a country, or as we do with the person, the good, the bad, the beautiful, the ugly, the complexities. And for me, the kind of opposite of patriotism is not to take the country seriously, to create a caricature that's like a superhero, and really not understand almost anything about its past. And it's disconcerting to see that type of history gain such traction, because it will really undermine what the next generation knows if this continues. Before we turn to the Q&A, Kevin, one of the things we've talked a lot about in these conversations is different kinds of myths. They're not all the same. Some are intentional, some are very pernicious and clearly partisan. Others are, they come from a nostalgia, handed down stories we hear. Which are the ones you think are most urgent for historians to try to respond to at this point?
Well, yeah, we've got the partisan myths and what we call bipartisan myths. And so bipartisan myths are things like the idea that America has never had an empire. That's something that's fundamentally against our nature. Or the idea that Native Americans have vanished from our myth. I think liberals and conservatives have both pushed that. And those are troublesome myths. And it may be the myopia of the moment we're in, but I do think the more partisan ones are the ones that really need the most pushback, because they're the ones that are being pushed the hardest. There are really people actively spreading that disinformation for either political gain or profit, but there's a motive behind it and they're actively investing in that. These other ones kind of exist in the background. There's no one, I think, really aggressively pressing these. They need to be corrected, but the really pressing need, I think, are these partisan ones that are being shoved into the public sphere with a partisan motive.
And I would just add or conclude before we do the Q&A now that it's not simply is someone liberal or conservative who's telling you the history. Everyone has political perspectives. We're human and you have your preferences. I think what we're really talking about in this book are these arguments that come from someone's political perspective, but are disconnected from any kind of evidence. Rather than someone who studies history, gains a real understanding of it, and from that builds how they see the connection between the history and their politics, or lets the history shape and kind of allow their politics to evolve. And I think what we're dealing with is those two things are just not really aligned anymore, and people are just making things up often to push that political perspective. Let me ask a few of the questions that have come through on the Q&A. Let me start. Is there anything in our education system that could be improved to prevent citizens from so easily believing lies? And maybe Kathleen, you can take that one.
Yes, I'm so excited about this because both specifically in my field of study, which is the problem of white power radical violence, that in itself has a huge component of targeted recruitment of children, not only teenagers, but children. We're talking about these horrifying studies where it's, I think, five or six clicks from the homepage of YouTube to propaganda material by white power groups. And we're talking about kids as young as third and fourth grade. That I think reasonable people can agree that this is a big, big social problem. And we're talking about that all the way to the more macro level problem of understanding our history, talking about who we come from, and the civics education that we need for things like how does an election work? How does the Electoral College work? Was this election real or not? I think is a question that comes directly from, do we have a basic grasp of civics? So supporting the humanities, not just in college, but all the way through our education system, supporting historical education. And then I always tell people, if you can volunteer in your local library and see what your librarians need, people are on the ground doing this work, and you can do a lot in your own community that has real and measurable impacts with a lot of these different problems.
Anyone can take this, but let me read it. Is there an era in which you think America really was great? And I don't know if anyone wants to jump in. Okay, Akhil.
By world historical standards, I'd say the founding was extraordinary. More people got to vote than had ever been allowed to vote before in world history. And I began my piece not by saying Trump is bunk or Reagan is bunk or Al Gore is bunk or modern person. I said Beard is bunk. He was the most significant Charles Beard academic writing on the Constitution in the last century. And he knew the fact that I just repeated and hid it from the readers. And until actually my 2005 book came along, even my own teachers didn't know that. So we academics have to, it's not just the unwashed masses that don't listen to we smart folks. The academy had a big part. So I say, you know, if America was so bad, you know, why actually were people coming here in general? Now, half of America gets rid of slavery at the beginning. That's pretty extraordinary because it's not freeing slaves, it's ending slavery. Britain then leapfrogs us. They do us one better in 1833, and then we're playing catch up. And then the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, I would say, are pretty great things. Again, compared to the rest of the world at that time, the rest of the world later on and America are going to give women the vote. Because the Constitution isn't just the founding, it's the amendments. I would say they're pretty great. Martin King in the 1960s comes along, and we add some more amendments. So truthfully, this is one of the reasons I'm an originalist and so is Lincoln. We actually think that the Constitution has done some great things and some not so great things also.
Kevin, I think you wanted to jump in as well.
Yeah, I'll just follow up what Akhil said. I'd agree with that entirely. And another part of the Constitution is this framing that we're in search of a more perfect union. And for me, the times in which America has been truly great is when we've actually lived up to that promise. It's not when we've rested on our laurels and pretended everything is perfect and everything is fine and everything is great, but it's when we've rolled up our sleeves, when we've realized that the current status quo is insufficient for our needs, it falls short of our ideals as a people, and we change things. We did this after the tumult of the Civil War with the Civil War Amendment, a hugely important project which made us more of a perfect democracy. We did it during the Depression with the New Deal, when we really expanded what this country's government could do for its people. We did it again in the 1960s with the civil rights struggle and the Great Society to really expand what was on offer here. So we've constantly proven our greatness by recognizing how much more we have to go. And so I think that thing that was built into America from the beginning, this idea that the Constitution wasn't the end all and be all, and we immediately set out to amend it. We immediately set out with the Bill of Rights and set up a process to amend that, but also set a process to expand who we were as a people and as a country. And so that to me is when America has really shown its greatness, when it's wrestled with these problems in a meaningful way, not papered over them.
And I would just add right onto that it is what the problem is that when you have this kind of history, this patriotic history that has the U.S. coming out fully formed and perfect, and not understanding it's an aspirational nation. And it is in that aspiration that we hold these truths to be self-evident. That is where that greatness comes from. It is for that fight to make these truths self-evident. And it's when we rest on our laurels. It's when we think that we've got it all done. And so when folks are knocking, banging on the door, talking about inequality, talking about systemic oppression, and it's written off as, oh, this is a perfect nation, so you just don't want to work hard. That's when we don't do the work that needs to be done.
Another question is about where can people turn? I'm just looking for the question. Where are the best places to turn for nonpartisan history or historical sources? That's the question. A, is that the way to think of it? And B, where should one go to actually get that kind of learning? Kevin, you want to start?
Well, I mean, professional historians, this is going to sound self-serving, I think, strive to be nonpartisan in that, whatever our political beliefs, and there are historians who all across the political spectrum, we have a fealty to the sources. We have a loyalty to kind of the conventional wisdoms of our field. So I would hope that would be the case. But you can always go straight to the source. And there's a certain fetishism about primary sources, but there's also a way in which you can see that they're available now widely, and you can read them yourself.
One great resource that combines Kevin's idea of looking at the original and tries to offer very self-consciously a kind of nonpartisan analysis is a free website at the National Constitution Center. It's called the Interactive Constitution. I'm very proud of the National Constitution Center. I was one of the people who helped found it. Full disclosure, its president is one of my favorite students, Jeff Rosen. But you can go and read the Constitution online, and then it's called the Interactive Constitution. There are little essays for each. You click on any sentence of the Constitution, and there are three essays. He being Jeff Rosen, a liberal and a conservative commentator to write on what they agree about. You know, here's what we think this is and isn't about. And then each one of them writes a separate essay. And so you can kind of see the zone of thoughtful disagreement. And the National Constitution Center is chartered by Congress to study the Constitution. This is in the charter on a bipartisan basis. And they bring lots of people. Their board of directors includes, you know, Bush's, the people in the Bush family on the one side, and I think maybe the Obamas on the other, and they're trying to do that.
There's just a lot of ways in our day and age. One of the good things about technology, which has a lot of bad elements, there's a lot of primary source material out there it's been put together. You're not kind of randomly looking at material. So for example, there's a website, The Living Room Candidate, which I love to use with my students, which has campaign ads from every presidential election in the era of television. And you can go and watch it, and you can watch six or seven ads from each campaign, and you really get a flavor of where the parties are and some of these questions we've discussed today. I think there's a New Deal website also with a lot of great primary sources. The Miller Center in Virginia has put a lot of the Lyndon Johnson transcripts and recordings online, which are just the most unbelievable material, in my opinion, but I'm biased, obviously. But to hear kind of real world conversations from the Oval Office. So I think that's another place people interested in history should look, not to us, Jess, although they should get a copy of Myth America out with basic books. I have to do that plug. But the primary sources are just unbelievable. There's a Freedom Summer project that's been going on for a while, which is really astounding. There's several of them, actually, where you can hear oral histories, you can see memos, and there's context kind of essays that are included. So let me add that. Someone asked about the second. Oh, sorry, Kathleen, go.
I just want to hop in on this because it's exciting. I would also just say to the person asking this question that the thing that historians make, our output, is not usually supposed to be completely neutral. What we create is an argument, a historical argument. So one way to think about this question is not like, is this a totally neutral history, which is not what we're trying to do, right? The question is, what is the argument? And then what evidence would you need to support that argument? And that second one, I think, is what's missing from a lot of how we interact with history, like in the wild. People sort of just take something on whether they agree with it or not, right? And it's this is where we fall into confirmation bias and partisanship and sort of not really reading beyond. So all of these answers are asking you to ask this one question, which is, what evidence would you need to support that argument? So if the argument is make America great again, what evidence would you want to see about whether America was great before? How would you assess that? What kind of thing would you want to know? And a historical thinking mechanism would teach you how to go and find that evidence and then sort of test the hypothesis. So that's how historians work in the world. And I think that thinking about that one question, what evidence would you need to support this, is the way to sort of unlock it if you're not sort of a trained expert.
I think that's actually it's a great way to articulate how to think about this. And for everyone, when all of us go to graduate school, what you're taught isn't to learn, you know, fact A, and fact B, it's how to make an argument about history. That is what historians do. And we're taught to argue. We are not meant to agree. There's something called historiography, which is essentially, you know, taking issue and challenging or supporting a whole body of work that exists on a certain subject. And every topic has gone through phases where elements are challenged. We open up new perspectives because of new source material or different ways of thinking about a period like Reconstruction or period like the Great Society. Take your pick. And I think what you just said, Kathleen, is kind of spot on. What you're really looking for is to evaluate the argument. And once you start asking that question, then you start to see, what are we dealing with here? Does the person have goods? And you might not agree with it in the end, but do they have an argument that is based on kind of real documentation, real evidence, real scholarly literature to support what they're saying? And so I just want to kind of second that and push away from the idea that Kevin and I never say we are myth busting. We never do that. And none of our authors do that. What we're trying to do is make persuasive, compelling arguments based on this scholarly apparatus. Someone asked, we have a few more minutes, about one of the areas where history's front and center is the Second Amendment all the time. And it's kind of at the heart of a lot of big policy discussions. And so someone asked about myths about the Second Amendment that you'd like to dispel. Maybe Carol, I can start with you on that.
Because I wrote a book on the Second Amendment. Okay. And I think, so let me just do a quick piece on this. It was with the killing of Philando Castile, a Black man in Minnesota who had a license to carry a weapon with him. He explained to the police officer as he was reaching for his ID that the officer asked for. He said, look, I have a gun. I just want to let you know, because that's NRA guidelines. And the police officer just began shooting. So you had a Black man who had a license to carry weapon who was gunned down simply because he had a gun, not because he was threatening anybody, not because he was brandishing it. And so the question became, do Black people have Second Amendment rights? And I went, wow, I'm a human rights scholar. That's one of the questions I haven't asked. And so I went looking. And so I expected to find this debate back in the past that we have between individual gun ownership rights and the rights of the militia. Is this about the militia, or is this about the individual right to bear arms? And I think, to me, that is one of the major myths that has cropped up in our modern day times, because what they were talking about in the past was about the militia and the role of the militia. And what I saw was that, yeah, you had this militia that was there to fight a foreign invasion, but sometimes they show up when they were fighting the British, sometimes they wouldn't. Sometimes they would just like be there fighting and then they would just take off running. And George Washington was beside himself, just like, God love a duck. Would you just stand up and be there when I need you to be there? And when it came to domestic tyranny, you couldn't count on them then either. Where you could count on the militia was to put down a slave revolt. And you saw this angst among the slave owners, particularly in Virginia, about the role of the militia being put under the federal government, federal control in the U.S. Constitution. And you had this pushback from Patrick Henry and George Mason, who were like, we will be left defenseless because we can't count on those folk in Massachusetts and in Pennsylvania to send down the militia when the slaves rise up against us. And so you see this angst and this threat against the U.S. Constitution, which is a threat against the United States of America, unless they got protection. So yes, there were these other elements coursing around. The fear of a standing army, that was there. The need for some kind of protection against a foreign invasion, that was there. But what you see coursing through as we rise up to the Second Amendment is the need to have the protection to begin to the protection of the white community against this black population. And you see that come through in the 1792 Uniform Militia Act, which says that every able-bodied white male must join the militia and must have a gun. So you get this sense of citizenship and the protection of the white community by white males who own a gun. And that courses through. One of the things that I saw coursing through was that regardless of the status, the legal status of African Americans, that fear, that inherent fear of black people, that inherent description of African Americans as being inherently violent and criminal and dangerous courses through regardless of the legal status. And so when we see young black men shot on a porch because he rang the wrong doorbell, we're seeing that anti-blackness coursing through and the valorization of the Second Amendment in that. So to me, the big myth was this about individual rights? Or was this about a militia? And the documents make clear as you're looking at the laws from that period, and as you're looking at the debates over the ratification of the Constitution, makes it very clear that the fear of black people and the need for that militia was prominent.
We only have a couple minutes. Let me ask each of you this one question that the Brennan Center likes to end on, and we'll be succinct. To finish, what is one thing you want our viewers tonight to walk away with from the conversation this evening? Kevin, why don't I start with you?
One thing I'd like viewers to walk away with is the realization that democracy is not a spectator sport. We've all got to be involved.
Kathleen? Oh, you're muted.
Of course. Maybe one thing to remember is that history provides a toolkit for confronting difficult times. It teaches you how to slow down your newsfeed, how to think about complexity and near misses and roads not taken. And it's one of the biggest sort of untapped deposits of potential solutions that we have. So I think history is for everyone, and I hope people take the time to read books like this one.
Akhil?
I'd like folks to remember that for all its flaws, and there have been many, the Constitution was a profoundly democratic instrument, not just in its words, we the people, but in its deed. We the people actually got to vote on the thing. More people got to vote on it than ever before had been allowed to vote on anything in human history for all its limitations. In fact, in 8 of the 13 states, property qualifications were lowered compared to what they were ordinarily, and nowhere were they raised. And the Academy didn't tell Americans that for most of the 20th century.
Carol?
I would like to leave this conversation with our audience understanding the role of race and racism in shaping the contours of American history. When we try to remove that the ways that race and racism and white supremacy have shaped us, then we don't understand what we're looking at. And then we're not able to really think through it. When we see it, then we know what we're looking at and we're like, okay, got it. And I want us to really get it.
And I'll end by saying to everyone, I hope we can take away the centrality of learning history, studying history, debating history, and pushing back on efforts that are now taking place in many places of the country, not to allow the teaching of history with the complexities we've discussed tonight. I want to thank all the panelists for really a wonderful discussion. It was an honor to be part of this with all of you. And for the audience for joining us, for your enthusiasm, for your support, and for asking all of your questions. Once again, I'm Julian Zelizer, Professor of History and Public Affairs at Princeton University and co-editor of the book we've been discussing tonight, Myth America, Historians Take on the Biggest Legends and Lies About Our Past, available everywhere. And Kevin and I hope this book really is the start of a conversation which leaves us in a better place to understand what this country has been about. So thanks for joining us, everyone.